You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to BorisFX.com for the premium download.
So here is my final roto. You can see all my layers here. I can select them and open them up. Shift click, and you can see that they're all color coded. Just tons of shapes, and Silhouette can handle all these shapes no problem. And we'll just close this back up. And I have a folder for all my trackers down here just to be organized. And I label that layer with green and I turn it off. And then we'll just zoom in and look at the hair. You're probably wondering, why do I have three roto nodes here? Well, first of all, we'll just go in and we'll check out the hair. So this first roto node here is where I have rotoed the hair with the open shapes here, just as splines. I have not assigned a width. You can see it's all broken up into different layers for all the different open shapes and closed shapes. Let me just disable this. And in the next one, it's a copy. And then I assign the widths in this layer or in this node. And that's because if I want to go back and change anything, it's easy just to go do that in the first roto node here, my final with no edits. So now I have all the widths assigned. And then the last node here, I'm just going to disable that, is my node with motion blur applied. So you can see that if I open up a layer here that I have motion blur applied, and also down here in the node. It's an easy way for me to go back and forth and make changes. And if there's something that I changed in one layer here, I can just copy it back over to an edited layer here and make different changes. Because if you make a bunch of changes all in one node, if you're feathering and blurring and changing the widths, and then you want to make a change, you have to really go back and hunt through. So I like having duplicates. And here you can see we have our variable width shape here. We'll just go back to the node. This one doesn't have motion blur applied. Actually, let's go here. That's where I assigned the width. There we go. The variable width. So if I assign variable width, that's done in the last node that I want to touch. Because that, again, if you want to make changes, it's kind of a pain to just reset the whole thing. You just want to start fresh. So I have a couple shapes here. And then if you want to view your work in the viewer just to check it, you can just zoom out here a little bit. We can click on this viewer option here over black and turn off the overlays. And now you can see our roto. And this has some motion blur applied, but there's not a lot of blurring on the shapes. So there's still work to be done, but for the most part, it's a good way just to check your work. And if motion blur is too heavy, or it's just slowing down your machine, just disable that and turn on the one with no motion blur. And that goes a lot faster. And then we can check out the rest of the roto. We'll go back to straight. And we'll turn on our overlays. Just click in the viewer and they're back on. So there's definitely a lot of hair to do for this shot, but that's not uncommon. I just made sure that I stayed organized and broke it up into different areas and different layers. And then we have the rest of the body. Here's our hand, with our fingers looking like fingers. And you can see how my shapes are all overlapping and that the connections between the fingers is round. It's not a flat, not a flat area. And then we also here have these tassels, and you can see I've used open shapes for some of those tassel pieces because that's an easy way just to make a shape. You don't have to make a closed shape and edit all those points. You just have one line and assign the thickness later. And same with some of these tassels down here or the fringe. And these are all tracked layers as well. So if I go in here, we're looking at shorts upper fringe. I actually had several layers to help me out here. And I'll turn on my tracking shapes. There's the green tracking shape there, and there, and there. So I used all of these to help me with the roto. And we can just click the over black again, turn off the overlays. It was difficult, but the tracking really helped. And we'll just turn off the tracking shapes again. And it looks like I have one on for the leg here, which I can just go down and turn off. So this is the final shot, but we have one more step. We're going to render out a movie of a slap comp. Now that we are at the end of class 3, it's time to do an export, and this time we will render out a movie file of a slap comp of a red test of our mats. So here we have our roto, and here's our slap comp node. I've chosen a red color with an opacity of 46%, and now we're going to output. And we can output in a movie file format because Silhouette now supports GStreamer. So here down in the output node, we can choose our options. I'm going to choose the ProRes 422, a QuickTime movie file, a half res of our plate, and Apple ProRes encoder, and the type is ProRes 422 HQ. Everything else looks correct. Close this box, and then we'll make sure that our pathing is correct. I've chosen my exports folder, QC movies, and now we can render. This all looks good. And now let's load it in. I'm going to double click in the sources window. And here's our movie file here. And bring it into our viewer. We can either bring it into our Silhouette project to look at, or we can just view it externally. So this is just another feature that Silhouette has that's really great to help QC your work. Thanks for joining me in this class, and I'll see you in the next one.